Welcome back to Latest News with me, Andrew Kay. This week marks the Jewish festival of Passover, and we met with one of Brighton's rabbis to find out about the event and its significance. Yael Breuer reports.
The Jewish festival of Passover is celebrated all over the world this week. And with me in the studio is Rabbi Pesach Efyun from Brighton Chabad to talk about the festival and how it's celebrated in the city.
Hello.
Hello.
Good day.
Welcome to the studio. We've just spent a few minutes talking about Brighton Albion football, but another significant thing to talk about is Passover.
That's it.
So tell me a little bit about the festival. A lot of people are celebrating it this week around the world and also in Brighton. What are they celebrating? What are they marking?
Okay, so what we're celebrating is the Exodus from Egypt, which really inaugurated the birth of the Jewish people. History tells us that if you recall, the family of Jacob landed up in Egypt. The Pharaoh enslaved them, possibly the first act, recorded act of anti-Semitism, maybe, if we want to go down that route.
Right.
And through a whole series of different miraculous events brought about by Moses, on the night of the Hebrew month, the 15th of Nisan, that is the month that we are in at the moment in the Jewish calendar, we went free after the 10th and final plague, which was the death of all the firstborn.
Right.
So we are celebrating freedom. That's a festival of freedom.
And the Jewish people, the Hebrews who left Egypt and went to the land of Israel, spent a long time in the desert?
Yes, they got a bit lost there.
Right.
The journey wasn't as quick as it might have been.
Okay.
But that's also part of the narrative. But really, the main aspect of the narrative is the fact that we're celebrating freedom. And I want to just make a point, because what's interesting over here, it's not freedom so much from slavery, but it's freedom to. You know, you can make a person free, but then what happens when you become free? And it's that going further, which actually was 49 days later on, when the Jewish people stood at the mountain of Sinai and received the Ten Commandments and the Torah. So when Moses comes to Pharaoh and says, please let my people go, he says, let them go so that they can serve me. So that was the purpose of going free. It wasn't just wandering. Yes, and I think that's an important aspect which a lot of people seem to miss.
Okay. And so people gather around the table and read the story. Is that right, every year?
Yes. What's remarkable about all the Jewish celebrations, festivities, a special point is made that the festivities should be done in a group. We can celebrate any of the other festivals by oneself. There's no specific obligation. But when it comes to Passover, there is special mention that we should do it with a group of other peoples. And therefore, throughout the world, even in Brighton, we will find people coming together, families coming together. My family's coming from different parts of the world. They make an effort, if not with your family, perhaps with a communal evening, which is called a Seder. There is a specific order of conducting the service, as it were. But it should be celebrated in a group, yes.
Right, yeah. And in Brighton, there's a big communal one at the Jewish Center, is that
there,
right?
There is one there. But
you're organizing?
Yes. But also, in all the synagogues, they seem to have community sedorim, these Passover celebrations. Especially, I think so, in Brighton, because there are a lot of single people here. There are a lot of elderly people who are alone. Families perhaps live somewhere else. So people really appreciate coming together, at least on this particular occasion, to celebrate.
I'm
yes,
sure, lovely.
Yes, yes.
So you've got a couple of things to show me to do with yeah. Passover.
I'll tell you what is remarkable about the celebration. You know, I was thinking when I came about the Mayflower, the Pilgrim Fathers in 1620, I believe it was, they arrived in America. Now, I think today, if you were to ask a descendant of one of those people, tell me a little bit more. Do you remember the exact date they arrived?
Right.
Do you remember what food they ate? Right? They probably wouldn't be able to tell you. And yet, for the last 3,300 years, speak to any young Jewish child and they'll tell you, ah, the Jewish people, we became free as a nation on the 15th of Nisan. And I'll tell you what we ate. We ate these matzah. Okay. Now, the story of the matzah is a very interesting one, because they had to leave in great haste, as the Bible tells us, the narrative tells us. And so quickly they had to leave that the dough, which they were preparing to bake into loaves of bread to take on their journey, didn't have time to rise.
Because they were on the run.
They had to get out. Pharaoh wanted to get them out as quickly as possible, and they wanted to leave. They weren't going to hang around any longer.
No.
This was the moment they had been waiting for. So on Passover, for not only on the night of the celebration that we're speaking about, but the whole 7-8 days, we don't eat bread or cakes or anything which are considered to be leavened. Unleavened bread is this thin matzah, which in a few moments, Yael, if you behave yourself, if you're a good girl, I will let you taste a little bit.
Great.
This particular matzah, perhaps some of your viewers are not familiar with this one, because as you can see, it is round. And this particular matzah was hand-baked. Okay, so we have...
As opposed to the ones you buy in the supermarket.
They are made in a machine, so therefore they all look uniform. Each one is square, and they all look the same. But this one, as you can see, is a little bit burnt. It's placed in a very, very, very hot oven for literally less than a minute, and it comes out looking like this. So, Yael, if you want to taste a little bit of that matzah...
Thank you. I do like a matzah.
Okay. I don't know if you can... they're a lot crispier, perhaps, than the ones that you might be familiar with.
I know you're the expert, but can I just tell you that my grandmother...
Yes.
...used to put butter and salt on a matzah.
Okay.
Forget Nutella, forget, you know, egg mixed.
Absolutely.
It is the best thing.
It is, absolutely. I agree with you. I agree. So, but on the night of Pesach, we don't eat it with anything. We eat it specifically
just
plain
anything,
so that we can get the taste of the matzah. We're looking forward to tasting this, which is remarkable that we're still eating this food. People sometimes speak about Jewish food. I believe the only food which is really Jewish is the matzah. All the other food that we eat really is Eastern European, or perhaps if Jewish people came from the Middle Eastern countries, falafel, for example. It's an Israeli dish, but it's not particularly a Jewish one.
Right.
But matzah is the
true
food,
Jewish cuisine.
True Jewish cuisine, and it still survived in its simplicity.
Right.
So there we have that.
Very quickly, is there anything else that you wanted to show me?
Yes, Yael, I'm so happy you asked that question, because we tried to make the evening a fun evening. So these are my bags of my finger puppets with all the different plagues. If you remember, there were 10 plagues. So this one is the plague for the death of the cattle. And I won't bore you with all of them. But here we have, this is the boils. And the kids always wait for Grandpa to take them out of his magical bag.
I wish I could, was coming to your Passover meal
well,
now.
Well, there you go. and there's the darkness. Anyway, that's my magical bag.
Thank you very much, and have a very happy Passover.
Thank you, and same to you and your family.
Thank you.